Hey, Robert, long time no see.
Good to see you again. Thanks for having me on.
Of course. I'm very excited for this podcast. Awesome. I'm kind of very into space and planets and all those things. And
I am too. You know,
so let's start out by, can you say your name and what you do?
Sure. I'm Robert Hogg. I'm the mission manager for the Mars 2020 project, and we run the Perseverance rover and the Ingenuity helicopter on Mars.
Amazing. Just no big deal. So you work at JPL, Jet Propulsion?
Yeah, this is out of the Jet Propulsion Lab, which is a NASA center in Pasadena, California. And JPL's main mission, if you will, is the unmanned exploration of the solar system. So not a lot to do with astronauts, but all the robots and rovers that get sent to other planets, and also spacecraft, are robotic explorers. So the Voyager spacecraft that flew by the different planets in the 70s, and they are now outside of the solar system. That those were done by JPL, and the missions to Cassini and Jupiter, and all the Mars missions. So amongst all the robots and landers that were ever landed on Mars, except for the most recent Chinese one, and we welcome them to the planet, all those were done by the Jet Propulsion Lab, which is where I work.
Amazing. Can you talk a little bit about the 2020 Mars project, like when you started and kind of leading up to that?
Sure. And if it's all right, I'll show a few pictures and screenshots of a few things about the project. Does that work for you?
Amazing.
Okay, good. So Mars 2020 is called Mars 2020 because it was planned to be launched in 2020, and we pulled that off despite COVID and other situations. So actually, before I forget, these are all the different missions to Mars that JPL has worked on. So the first two were landers that landed in the 70s called the Vikings. They were landers, not rovers. And then the first rover was 1996, and it landed in 97. Actually, the week that I started working at JPL is when the Sojourner Pathfinder mission landed. And then Spirit and Opportunity in 2004, and then a couple other landers. And then Curiosity in 2012, which is a one-ton rover, which I worked on for many years. And then this project is Mars 2020, and the rover is called Perseverance. And basically, I've been working on 2020 since roughly the end of 2013. So it's been a 10-year project for me. I was part-time, and then I went full-time. And so this is our rover. It's got seven amazing instruments and an oxygen generation machine, which I can tell you about. But basically, the purpose of the project is we've had these other rovers and landers on Mars, but this particular rover is capable of detecting signs of life. We call that biosignatures. And the way it does that is using spectrometers and other instruments. So we're over there investigating the geology of the planet, astrobiology, and we have a whole sample containment system or caching system where we take little samples of rocks and the Earth to be brought back, of the terrain, rocks and samples to be brought back to Earth eventually. And then also we have this oxygen generation experiment, which is turning some of the atmosphere to oxygen, which can be used by astronauts later. So that's kind of the punchline on the mission, Josh, is we're looking for signs of life, but ancient microbial life. So meaning we are, you can abstract it, and I do like to abstract it too. We're looking for life on another planet, but the way we're doing that is we're looking for signs of what could have been ancient bacteria or viruses or, you know, lichen. And before I forget to mention it, I should say I am not a biologist. I'm an engineer. So take all of my statements with regards to biology and with a grain of salt. But again, back to the main purpose of 2020 is explore different regions of Mars, find the most interesting looking areas, look below the surface of that rock or that terrain, because it's a really fascinating surrounding scientific signals that we're getting, and then drill a sample of that interesting thing and cache the sample inside the rover to be brought back to Earth later, which I will explain how we'll do that. But what that means is we're bringing back the best pieces of another planet after years of exploration to see if we can find signs of life that didn't come from this planet. That means we would go from we've only found life on Earth to we found life somewhere other than Earth. And if you just take that concept and go from there, in my opinion, it gets pretty compelling.
Well, I mean, that's like history, you know what I mean? Like that'd be a huge milestone. Then I guess my next two questions are one, so I guess you haven't found aliens yet.
No. We have global orbital maps of the whole planet. We haven't found any cows. We haven't found any trap doors leading anywhere. We haven't found trees on Mars, and we have not found aliens unless they're very, very, very good at hiding from our cameras and our spectrometers. And yeah, it's so far, back in the day when Galileo and others were looking at Mars with telescopes, they saw some signs of canals and things. And so they were thinking, well, there's a whole other civilization over there. They obviously have roads and canals, and so we should go over and visit sometime. And, you know, science fiction books were written about just going over and getting in contact with that other civilization. But when we sent these orbiters by, these spacecraft, and then later landers, it became clear from the orbital images taken by the spacecraft in orbit, that it's a big, dusty kind of desert type situation. But there's weather, there's, you know, little dust devils that go by, there's ice under the surface. So interesting planet, closest thing to Earth in this solar system, but no aliens yet. But we are looking for aliens and signs of life.
I'm sure there's a lot of ground to cover. So next two questions are, do you have a plan of when you're going to get those samples back? And then the other question after that is, how is it that you plan to do that?
Sure. Once we're done filling all the sample tubes that we have, they're titanium tubes about this big, and we have a coring drill, and we take about 4 to 7 centimeters of sample, like a rock core, and we store those in these tubes, and then they get imaged and measured and stored inside the rover. And once we've covered miles and miles and miles, all the different interesting places that the whole science team wants to go to. And side note, we have hundreds of scientists working on this mission from different, you know, around the world. And two project scientists who lead the mission. The head project scientist is a professor at Caltech, which is near JPL, and Caltech runs JPL. So we have a world-class science team that's guiding where we send the rover to look for these samples. So once we've finished filling up all the sample tubes, which will be over the next few years, somewhere between 4, 5, 8 years, something like that, maybe 6. The reason we have so much time to explore and fill those tubes is the return mission is currently being, the architecture of it is being finalized, so that then we can move on to detailed design. And so back to your question, we will rendezvous. So a lander, a whole other mission will be sent to Mars with a rocket, launching it off of Earth in a spacecraft. It's going to be a lander. It lands. We will drive the rover back to the rendezvous point where we intend to land it. We will drive the rover up to the lander, hand off the tubes from the rover. The tubes will be put into a little package about this big, maybe the size of 2 footballs, maybe 3 footballs. That will be sealed, put into the nose cone of a rocket. A rocket which is the first rocket ever to be launched from another planet. And then the rocket will go into orbit. And then another spacecraft being made by the European Space Agency, who are our partners, will rendezvous with the package of samples in orbit around Mars, capture it in orbit, and then return back to Earth. And then you put a little heat shield around the package and land it in the middle of nowhere in a desert in Utah. And so I'm going to show you, I happen to have something that shows that whole process. And I think it's worth amazing. Seeing the visuals of what I'm talking about. So here we go. All right, so it's still in work, but that is the notional plan.
That is so cool. That is so cool.
Thank you. It's a multi-year, actually multi-decade campaign, which can be excruciating sometimes. But when you're in the middle of it, it's all flying by so fast. So right now, we would get those samples back roughly 10 years from now. But
Wow. That
is okay. They won't expire. They're perfectly sealed, almost explosively sealed. And then we would be able to take those roughly 30 samples and scientists from all over the world can take turns analyzing them in rooms full of lab equipment to see what we've found.
That's amazing. Do you think that before you get those samples back in 10 years, you might end up sending a few more missions to Mars before that time?
I'm so embedded in my project, I don't know all the proposals that are out there, but right now, the next mission to Mars for JPL and NASA would be this sample return campaign. The lander, right now, as of today, the lander is scheduled to launch in 2028, in 5 years. And then, that the return spacecraft that captures the samples in orbit would launch, I think, a year earlier. I think we're looking at the launch dates, and that might change. But, right now, our rover And actually, the Curiosity rover, which is still running, are the two operating surface assets of the planet. We also have three NASA orbiters that are aging a little bit. Some are newer, some are younger, but they're still going strong and doing great science from orbit with different instruments and obviously cameras. And the Europeans have a phenomenal orbiter called the TGO orbiter, which we also relay data through from our robot when we're sending our all of the data back on a daily basis.
Wow, that's amazing. So right now the purpose is really just collecting data, but this might be a general dumb question, but is it to maybe look at potentially one day living on Mars, having some sort of population on Mars?
Yeah, I think that's a fantastic question, and actually really a compellingly philosophical question. I will give you my own view, okay? So I'm not speaking for NASA and JPL, but many at NASA and JPL would agree with me. I think that it would be good to have another human base on another planet, and the best planet to do that with would be one in this solar system, just because of the limitations of human space travel at this time. It takes 4 light years to get to the nearest star. That's the closest sun to our sun. 4 years at the speed of light to get there. So that kind of limits us as far as a secondary outpost for humans to be the planets in this solar system. And of the planets in this solar system, Mars is the most realistic for humans to land on. And we've sent these robotic explorers over there, and that was intentional. We send robots first before sending humans somewhere now because we have the robotic technology, but also because it's safer for humans. It's actually far less effort because when you're sending humans somewhere, they need to breathe oxygen, drink water, eat food, need to send an exercise bike, or their muscles start degrading in zero gravity, and there's all this stuff to support the human body, whereas a robot, you stick it on the nose of a rocket, it doesn't care how many G's of force it's experiencing, and it our robot was tested to minus 120 Celsius on a thermal cycle a daily basis. Mars temperatures right now go up to about 0 Celsius and then down to minus 80, something like that, every day.
And wow, it's a lot colder than I thought it would be.
Yeah, it's and actually, side note, you can Google Mars 2020 weather. We have a weather station on our robot, and we have it tied into this public website, and the weather data gets posted automatically every day, and you can see the temperatures on Mars over the last 10 days or so. But so,
wow,
robots can easily survive dangerous environments, but also, and this is very key, our rover weighs a ton, 2,000 pounds, okay? So it's like a light, small car. And so while that may seem heavy, it's nothing compared to the amount of mass that you need to send a person somewhere.
Right.
And then also, we humans don't like letting other humans die unnecessarily, so we need to bring the humans back to Earth. But for a rover or a robot, you don't need to do that. You can send it one way, and it just stays there and does its job, and it's a tool. It's a remote tool, and we keep running it until, you know, if it has solar panels, until dust accumulates on the solar panels and it dies, or the radioactive engine in the back of our rover winds down, or some other problem because of all the environmental dangers. And so then it just stays there. We don't have to bring it back. So all this means you don't have to send as many rockets or rocket fuel to get something over to Mars to explore with. You can just send one mid-size rocket instead of, you know, 12 large rockets to send people. So that's why we've sent robots first and not people yet, but we're getting there. And so actually, let me show you something else. I mentioned this oxygen generation experiment. So that is for a human, the human exploration directorate at NASA. We sent one of our instruments, which is called MOXIE. So a professor and his students came up with a way of making oxygen from carbon dioxide. And this is, wow, you know, on a bench over at MIT 10 years ago or something. And so carbon dioxide is what humans breathe out and what trees breathe in, right? So it's carbon and two oxygen. So they have this stack of metal, different metals in a stack that have slices, and they run electricity through it. I don't know all the details of the experiment, but they have a catalyst. They run electricity through it, and this box takes in carbon dioxide, and it spits out oxygen, pure oxygen that humans can breathe. So we helped them. They worked on miniaturizing their experiment, and expert engineers at JPL spent a bunch of time with them miniaturizing their oxygen generator, and they got it down to this box. And we have this box embedded in the right side of our rover, and it's got an outlet. And it has run on the order of 10 or more oxygen generation runs at different temperatures, at different seasons, and different at different times. And it sucks in the carbon dioxide straight from the Mars atmosphere and spits out oxygen. And this slide is outdated. They're up over 100 grams of oxygen. So they've generated, let's see, something like enough oxygen, I think, for a small dog to breathe for like a day or something like that.
Oh, wow.
So you take that piece of technology, you scale it up a little bit or put a big one in your Mars rover, and that's one of the ways that we will allow the first astronauts to walk on Mars and explore Mars. They're going to be able to breathe oxygen straight from this little atmospheric transformation. So
that's amazing.
We're getting there in steps on sending humans to Mars. NASA has the Artemis program, which is a big campaign to send humans back to the moon. So we'll have the first woman, the first person of color land on the moon, and we're going to have a base orbiting, and I think a small base on the moon. And so that's good practice and a good stepping stone for sending humans to Mars, because, you know, can't breathe on the moon, and it there's a lot of similarities. And so then the next step would be, after the Artemis program is successful over the next few years, is, in my opinion, again, is to start planning that human Mars mission for real. And then it would be something like, you know, on the order of 10 big rocket launches, because you need to send the habitat for them to sleep in, and the return rocket, like a big version of the one that you saw in the video, and the food and the water and extra rocket fuel to fuel the rocket to bring them back to Earth, because we don't want to just leave them there. And then it would be like a 5 or 6 month voyage. And then depending on Earth and Mars orbits, it would be like a 1 month stay or a 1 year stay, and then another 6 month return voyage. So we're getting there, baby steps on sending humans to another planet.
Well, I like that you guys are working very hard to, when you do send humans, ensure that they're going to live instead of haphazardly just sending some people there.
Yeah, I think it's safe to say that NASA doesn't plan or conduct missions where, you know, human life is part of the plan. We always intend to bring everybody back safe, and they've had a, you know, a fantastic adventure.
That's amazing. So just to go back to the rovers on Mars, can you talk a little bit more about what they are and what they do and kind of their daily life?
Sure. So let me, I'll show some more pictures here to help explain that. So we spent on the order of 10 years building this rover. You can see my screen, right?
Yeah.
Great. So we've been operating it since 2021. You have the general idea on what you want the mission to do. You get proposals from scientists and groups all over the world. 7 instruments were selected. We built a whole sampling caching system from scratch, which is this robotic system over here. There's a robot arm that manages the tubes. And, you know, over a 7 or 8 year period of design, conceptual design, and then critical design, and then final design, and then testing and validation, and then integrating the whole thing together, and then testing different parts, and then reintegrating it together. And in a big clean room, at the end of the day, you have something that looks like this. So this is the final clean rover that is ready to go to Mars. And before I forget to mention, here is a little stowaway. That's the Mars helicopter, which I'll tell you about in a second.
Okay.
So this is ready to go, and then you put the Mars landing engine on it, and it's now a whole. This package goes in the nose cone of the rocket, and this engine is what's used to land the rover. This is where we landed on Mars. It's called Jezero Crater. So a team of scientists spent, you know, scientists from all over the world had ideas on where to land this, but we decided to land it at the end of the day, after they had many conferences and finalized the sites. This is the edge of this crater, and there's this delta. It's a delta is a flow. I didn't know that before I started this project. So there's this giant flow of material from outside the crater into the crater of that was accomplished using water. So material flowing with water maybe would have good possibilities of life existing somewhere in here. So we wanted to land the rover somewhere near that delta in this circle, and then we would drive the rover along the bottom of the crater up onto the delta and take samples to be brought back. And that's exactly what happened. So some other time I will show you how you land a rover on Mars. Actually, here's the short version. This is always worth talking about landing on Mars when you're talking Mars, Josh. So on February 18th at 12:55 p.m. Pacific time, this is what happened. This is the simulated version, and I'll show you the longer version another time. So it comes down in a it gets slowed down to hundreds of miles per hour with a hypersonic parachute, and then the heat shield gets ejected. And then that package with the engines and the rover comes out, and that slows it down to tens of miles per hour. And then so that we don't kick up dust and rocks, we lower the rover on wires and then sever the wires and send the engine away to crash. So we land this 1-ton rover on Mars, and this is the first view of Mars after landing. This is actually a picture I took from my cell phone of my desk on landing day. I and the rest of the surface team got handed the keys to the spacecraft 20 minutes after landing. This is the first picture we took of the vehicle and our new home, showing its shadow, and here's a wheel. And then this is looking out the back. And these are some of the first pictures of, here, I'm just gonna hide that. These are some of the first pictures that we got with our zoomed in science camera. And so imagine, you know, you spent 7 years on this thing, you've landed, and this is what you get to explore. It was fantastic. These wow. These hills in the distance is the edge of the crater, and all these interesting rocks and things happening geologically in the foreground. So you take this rover, and the general scheme is you drive over to an interesting area, and then I'll show you some of the other parts of the rover. So you drive with these wheels, and this is the robotic arm, and you've got this remote science camera on top of the mast, and you take a picture of, like, say, this interesting area, and then you unstow the robotic arm and put the instruments that are up close, that are at the end of the arm, up close to the surface, and then you can abrade. I'm going to fast forward here. We'll come back to the helicopter in a second. Don't forget to let me tell you about the helicopter. So then here's the robotic arm up close to the surface. Here's the wheel on the left. This is underneath the rover. This is the camera underneath the rover called the hazard camera. And this is a close-up picture using a camera at the end of the robotic arm of this surface area. And look at this picture. Look what you can see.
That's so incredible.
Let me just put this in perspective for you for a second, okay? Mars is, it depends on Earth and in Mars orbit. Sometimes they're closer to each other. Sometimes they're far apart. Like right now, they're on opposite sides of the sun, and they're very far apart. So Mars is probably around 300 million miles away right now. Wow. So, you know, my wife and I drive to Yosemite all the time. We jump in our car, and we drive 300 miles to get to Yosemite. And that takes us, you know, 6 hours, 7 hours. So if you got in a car and started driving towards Mars right now, like Elon's Tesla, right, that's in orbit, you just start driving that thing at about 60 miles an hour towards Mars, it would take you over 500 years to get there, one way.
Jesus.
So Mars is far. It takes radio signals at the speed of light to get back and forth from the moon a few seconds. And it takes light from the sun to get to Earth about 8 minutes. It takes our radio signals at the speed of light to get to Mars and back right now about 22 minutes. Okay. So wow. Seconds is how far away the moon is. And 22 minutes at the speed of light is how far away Mars is. So we now have this... this vehicle sitting on Mars with a camera up close to the surface that's like 1 centimeter, 2 centimeters away from the surface, 300 million miles away. You get what I'm saying here as far as just, you know, an engineering...
Look at that image.
Yeah, an engineering statement. Engineers and scientists were able to bring back this image that was taken 2 centimeters away from a very interesting surface 300 million miles away. You got it. So then after that, if we like what we see, we have this abrasion tool at the end of the arm, and we abrade or take off the top surface of this rock that we're interested in, and then we blow it clean with a little puffer, like it's got one of those like CO2 cartridges in it, or the equivalent. And then this is the cleaned off surface underneath the surface of this interesting rock. And this is spectacular, right? The things that are happening in this piece of material and the voids that are here. And then we put 2 spectrometers that can read that read the spectra of light coming off this material to see what it's made of and the different molecules that are in there. And then if we like what we see there, we take a sample. And so this is one of the first... rock core samples that we took on Mars. Here's the abrasion over here next to it. And the sample looks like this inside of our drill bit. So this is the sample inside the tube taken from a camera inside the rover. So that, what you're seeing right there, that material is currently in a tube inside the rover. And that interesting thing there that you're seeing is what's going to be brought back to Earth.
Wow, and so, it's literally rock from another planet. That's
yes.
Incredible.
The most interesting part of this other planet that world-class scientists have determined that we should bring back and see what's in there. And they've got, you know, carbon dating techniques and all kinds of other things that I don't understand that they can find out the most amazing things about what's happening here in, you know, in this area of Mars with this context, including pictures and spectra of the rock around here and all this context, including from orbital context of, you know, this stuff that was happening here and this over here, all in relation to that one sample, wow. If that makes sense. So that's in general how we run the mission. And that happens every day. We send the rover commands, and it carries out the commands, and then it reports back through the orbiters throughout the day. And then the next day, the next Martian day starts, and we send the next group of commands. And that's how we're exploring this other planet.
Wow. So this might be another dumb question, but do you sit in like a mission control at JPL, and are you able to see like a 22-minute live feed of Mars?
Yeah, no, definitely not a dumb question. So here, I will go back to the landing day since it shows our mission control area. So let's see. Do I have one of the surface? Well, anyway, tell you what. Let me find the one that shows both mission controls. Give me 1 second. Okay, I think I got it. All right, so we'll share again. This is our surface mission control. Oh, wow. So this is where the team receives the data and pictures and instrument information and everything on a daily basis. I run this mission control as the mission manager. So here's me on landing day in the middle of COVID. We're all masked up with our, you know, our Mars 2020 masks on. this whole thing was, you know, televised. We spent 10 years working on one of these things, or 8 years, or 5 years, or whatever. And then for one day, during that landing, we have all kinds of, everybody from all over the world is tuned in with us. And this is the moment that we found out that we landed successfully.
Wow.
So there's one of the mission controls. There I am. I got to be there running the surface mission control area, and this is the entry, descent, and landing mission control area, and I'll cut to the end here. And actually, you'll appreciate something here coming up, I think, Josh, which I'll explain. So that's from a camera that's pointed down as we got close to the surface during landing.
Wow. All that dust.
On this mission, we had commercial off-the-shelf cameras, like a GoPro, but not a GoPro, sitting mounted on the rover facing down. Here, let me... I'll push ahead here. On the rover facing down, which is this image, on the rover facing up, so you can see the landing engine as it gets lowered, and on the landing engine facing down so you can see the rover. So here's all three of those playing in real time together right at the end of the landing sequence. So we're lowering the rover to the surface, and then those cables get cut, so the bottom left image will get cut off, and then you'll see the landing engine fly away as far from the rover as possible, and then you'll see the reaction.
Whoa.
On the surface of Mars, ready to begin seeking the sands of past life.
So we went nuts.
That's a little history. Yeah.
It was. I mean, some other time when we have more time, I'll show you some of the other reactions around the world. But like, you know, it was on the big screen in Times Square and in viewing areas all over the world. And we lit up the Eiffel Tower with red and our logo. And just like that day, that evening, that afternoon, everybody was with us on this thing.
What's it like for you to be in charge of something that's a part of history for the entire planet?
Well, thank you for saying those words. We're in the daily grind. As it were, you know, sometimes you're staring at spreadsheets for hours, eyes going blind, or working out something on a whiteboard in a meeting, or trying to get everybody aligned in the same direction on X, Y, Z thing. But if you pop up to the big picture, and this is what we talk about on the team, after everything that we've been through, we've successfully landed a national asset. And really, it's not just a U.S. asset, although, you know, it was entirely done by U.S. and foreign partners, not entirely done by U.S. We have partners in Norway, and the weather station was done by the Spanish. So partners around the world, but U.S.-led. This is a mission for humans of Earth, and it's an asset, a national, it's a worldwide treasure. And so we have to be careful in our management of it And so I and the team focus on that daily, on being careful that we're doing the right thing so we don't do something wrong and lose it unnecessarily. And also, because of the big picture that I've described to you, the rest of the sample return campaign needs to play out. And so we're the tip of the spear on making that happen and getting these amazing samples to be brought back. But if something catastrophic happens with the rover, you know, there's no reset button where you can just go turn it off and turn it on and restart it, like, you know, like we did at the beginning of this podcast, right? it's there, and you can't just go hit the reset button. So we have to be very careful with it, but at the same time, we want to be very productive and get the most amazing, interesting, scientifically compelling samples to be brought back. So it's very exciting, on the edge of your seat sometimes, like when we're landing the rover and flying the helicopter, and when some hardware problem shows up, it gets very serious, but everybody puts their game faces on to figure this thing out, you know, and make sure that we don't lose this beautiful thing that we have that's exploring another planet for us. So it's pretty exciting, to answer your question.
That's incredible. I guess I'd love to end with what's next for you guys.
We've got another. So for this project specifically, we're going to continue exploring Mars outside of the crater, and there's a couple other interesting areas we need to get to and get some samples, because they could be really amazing to be brought back. Make this whole sample return mission go. That whole lander and spacecraft, all that stuff still needs to be designed and built and tested and sent. JPL is working on other missions as well in parallel. We just launched one called Psyche, which is a spacecraft that's flying to an asteroid that's almost entirely metal.
Wow.
Think about that for a second. It's entirely made of metal. And so we're going to go investigate that asteroid. Soon we have another spacecraft called Europa Clipper, which will be flying to the planet Europa and doing flybys of that and orbiting it and taking pictures. And then we might be sending a robotic surface explorer to Europa, depending on what we find. And then, as I mentioned, the human exploration program continues, sending humans to the moon. And then beyond that, the universe is our oyster as far as where humans go and where we send robots first.
Are you allowed to say anything in terms of potential dates of when we're going to send humans back to the moon?
I don't work on that program, so I don't have them off the top of my head, but it's an easy Google search. You just look for the Artemis program.
Okay.
We NASA just finished some major milestone tests on the big rocket that will be used for that, and so we're well on our way. So don't quote me on this. Again, do the Google search, but I think next year or the year after, something in that time frame, the next couple of years, we should be launching humans for that lunar mission.
Amazing. And then just for the people that are listening, is there a website that people can go to kind of get updates on JPL and the Mars rover and how that's...
Yeah, absolutely. If you just type in Mars space 2020 into Google, you'll find our mission. There's a raw images site in there on the webpage that... Literally all the pictures that come from the rover and the helicopter get dumped on the internet within seconds or minutes, depending on how fast things are running, after we get them down. We receive them on the Deep Space Network. We get them in our mission support area, and they get dumped to the internet. That's the raw images site. Like I mentioned, the weather site is there, and then also there's a Where is the Rover Currently on Mars site. So just Google Mars 2020. You can go to the Jet Propulsion Lab website. There's lots of good stuff there about all of our missions. And then, of course, NASA has YouTube channels and lots of websites out there for everybody who's interested in the lunar program, the mission back to the moon. So a lot of exciting stuff happening.
Amazing. Well, thank you so much for everything that you're doing. Obviously, in terms of potentially helping to expand mankind. all this stuff is so exciting to me. So I'm excited to see everything unfold.
Fantastic. Thank you for your interest in all this and getting the word out about what we're doing. And it's been great chatting.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Rob.
All right. Talk to you later.
Talk to you later.